All right, ready to get going? Let's do it. My name is Jonny Harvey, for those who don't know, and I've been making...
Thank you! Stop time! Incredible!
And for the last year or so, I've been working on a documentary about my family's comic book company, Harvey Comics. I never got a chance to meet my grandfather. He died before I was born, and I kind of just wanted to know about my grandfather, and through asking about, to my grandmother, to my father, they're like, yeah, he was, one of the three big heads of this huge comic company. And I was like, what do you mean? So, oh, we had characters like Casper The Friendly Ghost and Richie Rich, and I was like, well, what are you talking about? Do we have any comics? Do we have any, what's the deal? And I kind of learned that Harvey was one of these, the huge four publishers, in the 50s, 60s, and 70s. They were the youngest brand of, comic books. They would do comics for the littlest of kids, and then the kids would actually kind of grow up, and they would grow into more mature lines like Archie and, DC and Marvel. And Harvey was the intro for a lot of people's, love into comic books. So basically, through learning that this company was so big, we had pretty much gone out and attempted to kind of recreate, the history of Harvey. We've been interviewing, former family members that I didn't even know existed until about a year ago, former employees at the company, different thought leaders and scholars that are trying to tell exactly why Harvey is so important, celebrities. We're interviewing a lot of people that were involved in Harvey films. I don't know if you guys remember like the Richie Rich movie with Macaulay Culkin. This is Regina Rich. We just got her a few months back, and she grew up adoring Richie Rich, which was awesome. Harvey started in the late 30s, and comic books back then really weren't a cool thing. It was just a bunch of Jews that couldn't find work in any reputable jobs because they just, anti-Semitism, And so they all got into this underground thing called comic book publishing, and it was pretty cool because they could do whatever they wanted. It was like the Wild Wild West. Comics became pretty big once it came into the Warriors. People needed things to do, when they were just hanging out overseas. My grandfather's twin brother actually made comic books for the Pentagon, and they would send these comic books, overseas. They would be informative as well as entertaining. It would be like a sanitation worker. Like, what do you do? How do you be a sanitation worker? And it would actually take you through it with pictures, because back then people really couldn't read in this country. We weren't a very literate country. So originally they were doing all these fun like superhero stuff, war stuff. They were doing stuff like Dick Tracy. They were doing Flash Gordon. They were doing detective stuff. They had the first woman superhero to have her own book 2 months before Wonder Woman. So my Wonder Woman girl's there. 2 months before that, they had a superhero called Black Cat, who was a stunt actress in Hollywood during the day, and she would fight crime and creepy dudes at night. Eventually,
they actually redid that. Pamela Anderson at some point on Comedy Central, striptease something?
Really?
Yeah. Stripperella.
It's gotta be happy, isn't
it? Did that happen?
So, they were doing all these like gory stuff, they were doing thriller stuff, they were doing detective stuff, they were doing all this crazy stuff that everybody was doing in the 40s, and then all of a sudden there's a thing that a lot of comic book nerds know about called the Comic Code, which was basically people were scared in the early 50s about the content that their kids were reading. They thought it was too graphic. They thought it was too gory and too sexual. And fortunately for Harvey, they had a very cushy relationship with Paramount. Paramount had all these cartoons like Little Audrey and Casper the Friendly Ghost. So boom, they have a great deal with Paramount, and they get all these characters like Casper, they got Little Audrey, and they created this whole world around these characters. They created Wendy, they created Spooky, they created Nightmare, and all these different lines, hot stuff. And they pretty much cornered this kids market. There really wasn't another publisher that had children consuming their books that much. And they also got to go on TV, which was huge in the 50s. If you were on one of the big three networks, ABC, CBS, NBC, everybody was watching those stations. 90%, maybe more, of households in America were on one of those stations. And they had prime time on Sunday. This company was huge. They were able to, you know, merchandise their products. And, you know, Casper was the head of the Dental Association, head of the Boy Scouts, head of everything you could imagine that'd be fun for kids. And they created a character called Richie Rich within the world of little Audrey and Casper. And this kid was the epitome of wealth. And Richie basically was the top-selling comic book character for kids of all time. They had 32 different Richie Rich lines. They had Richie Rich Millions. They had Richie Rich Billions. They had Richie Rich Dollars and Cents. They had Richie Rich Zillions, which is a real thing. They had 32 different comic book lines of this one character, and it was a sensation. It was insane. They were making all this money off Richie. And the story that I want to tell is not only a story about how Harvey became prominent, but what happened to Harvey. And through the documentary, and hopefully when I can show you guys the teaser in a minute, I can get there. But what? Basically, Richie and Casper were kind of the faces for Harvey for a while, and strangely, through a bitter series of events, it didn't really work out. So once I can show the teaser trailer, you guys can see a little bit more, but I'm gonna hand it over to Oley, who's got some things to say about his personal experience with Harvey growing up. And Oli's going to introduce himself, because I can't do it justice.
Hi, everybody. My name is Oley Sassone. I got involved in this through Jonny because I have a small relationship with comic books. I'm really not his grandfather. Although I was born and raised in the 50s and early 60s, and I did a film called The Fantastic Four, the original version in 1995 for Roger Corman. So, yeah, go out there and tell those people to release that goddamn movie, will you please? So, anyway, comic books is, I got to talk about this when I was doing the Fantastic Four, because when Roger called me and said, "Oli, hello, it's Roger," and I'd already made a couple films for him, and he said, "Doing this movie about the Fantastic Four, would you be?" And he got me a Fantastic Four. So I did the film for him, and the reason I was so excited about doing the film is because, as a kid, like most kids, growing up in the suburbs, comic books were the escape. I mean, that was it. We traded comic books. We had comic book cards, bubblegum cards. And it was an opportunity for us to talk back to our parents, get a reason to talk back to our parents, because you say, well, what does that mean? If you look at Harvey Comics in particular, adults in Harvey Comics were all symbols of authority. But they would be there as that symbol of authority, and people that would pressure them and give them, because they didn't really have, in the Harvey comic universe, which is Harveyville, they didn't really have like what superheroes have, villains like they have today. So it wasn't like a monster or something like that. And the characters of Harvey were just pretty much ordinary people, but they had extraordinary ideas about who they were, what they wanted to be. Not in the sense of a Spider-Man or the Fantastic Four. I mean, if you look at characters like Dot, she was obsessed with dots, literally. And everywhere she would go, she could find dots in fabric and dots in, and she would change the color of her dad's office by going in and painting it full of dots. And that was what her big thing was, to fight with the parents and the authoritarians about her painting dots. And little Lotta was overweight, and she had this insatiable appetite, but eating gave her superpower. So she was big, but she was strong, And so she could do things to help the other kids in the neighborhood, like little Audrey and so on and so forth. For instance, there was a scene where the raccoons and the, I checked out the Netflix, Harvey Kids is back on Netflix, and little Lot is out there helping them change the tire on an ice cream truck. And they had, she had to literally get under the truck and lift it up with her superpower. And of course, every time you saw little Lotta not doing superpower, you saw her eating. Here was a girl, and all the girls in the Harvey universe, they were empowered. They got good, you know, it was a good lesson, good moral compass and good empowerment. It was aspirational for young girls. I mean, little Lotta being overweight, you know, little Audrey was really smart and witty. She would always have to come up with it. It was very clever what they did, in fact, with people like Audrey. For instance, I was looking at some of the comics recently where she would had to give a younger child in her family a bath, and the girl was running away from her, and she'd run up the stairs and she'd come sliding down the banister, and that was the little girl's thing, slide down a banister to get away from little Audrey. So little Audrey, in her clever world, just said, okay, she wouldn't put a tub of water at the bottom of the banister. So the girl would go up, run away, come down, and boom, splash, there she is. And that was kind of like what little Audrey was about. And that was good for young girls, because they would think, you know, I can be somebody. I can, you know, like little Audrey and Dot. The point being that all these people, and particularly the young girls, they, even though they had issues that anybody else, like little Lotta, would be, I'm overweight, and I'm not pretty, and I eat too much, and I'm strong, and I can beat the crap out of any guys that come up and give me trouble, which she did. But she was empowered by it. She had a self-empowerment. She and I think that's what one of the messages was with all the girls, particularly in the Harveyville world, is that you can be who you want to be and have power to do it. And anyway, here's something to see.
There were only a handful of companies that survived over those five decades, and it was Marvel, DC, Archie, and Harvey.
Harvey had a brand.
One might call a gateway drug that was the Harvey books.
Wendy we created, Spooky we created, Nightmare we created, the Ghostly Trio. So we created a whole world of people that were interested.
They were progressive. They were one of the few, if only, comic book publishing companies that really knew that there was a huge market for young girls.
It seemed to be a family-run business.
They were really good at providing moral backgrounds to their characters and teaching lessons to kids.
The importance of honesty, the importance of doing good.
Casper, the friendly ghost, the friendliest ghost you know.
It really wasn't until they hit upon Casper and Richie Rich that they became a major player.
Richie Rich was a pure comic book phenomenon. Printing Richie Rich comics was literally like printing money.
Basically, Harvey bet everything on the farm on Casper and Richie Rich.
Over time, the generation who once loved it would outgrow it.
You didn't know how well any book was doing.
The characters had sort of fallen into this moribund state.
I mean, when Alfred got sick, it all changed. I mean, once he was moved aside, he did everything to disrupt things.
Harvey stopped printing.
Anytime there's a story of someone screwing up and losing ownership rights is a car wreck.
Why don't you think anything's happened with Casper since?
That's a good question.
So that's it. Derrick, I'm gonna let you go.
I am Derrick Wells. I am just your everyday comic book nerd. You know, Tiny, who was the first black character, like one of the, yep, it was Tiny. He hung out with Little Audrey and the rest of the game. And there were a lot of other characters that you guys might not know that were a part of Harvey. One of my favorites being Felix the Cat, who just was, he was my favorite because he was just, he had so much swagger. And, of course, he was black. Felix the Cat, I have to say, was a Nubian god. It carries over to this rap world today because he carried a Louis Vuitton bag that could pretty much do anything. I would think between him and Richie Rich and stuff, they made a great big, yes, sir.
What's a Nubian?
Black rage! I planted him there, by the way, guys. He's a little late on his feet. Anyway, the Harvey world, I do believe that there's characters like Scooby-Doo, like I said, my favorite Felix the Cat, just worlds spawned off into, Jack, I don't have to give you more, but it was spawned off into the Hanna-Barbera generation, which gave us things like Laugh Olympics, which we all love, where it combined all these different characters and companies into this one big thing. It was just Laugh Olympics, it was the shit. And over time, like you said, people grew out of it. But now we're all at that level now where this was our childhood and we're a different generation of adults, so our childhood is now our adulthood, which I don't know if that really makes sense. I hope you guys catch on to that. And from Hanna-Barbera, we spent off into Adult Swim, which is a world we all love. We got the opportunity and Hunger Force in the house. And I do believe to this day, there's a little bit of artists in everybody probably in this room because of things like Harvey Comics and just created our imaginations and just made us the people we are. And we are now a strong people as nerds all together, right?
Nerds united.
Nerds united, nerds to save the world. Unless you start the quarrel of if Die Hard is a Christmas movie or not. That's the only nerd thing I think is probably a little bit beef. But otherwise, nerds to save the world.
It's funny you mentioned, you know, the Hanna-Barbera stuff. When my family sold the company in the late 80s through for a bunch of different reasons, you know, kids kind of grew out of, you know, of the comic book world. They really weren't where children found comic books like they used to. They used to find them in candy stores. They used to find them, you know, on newsstands on their walk home from school. Their parents would just grab them, you know, to make sure that the kids had a gift, you know.
Waiting for them when they got home, and while the parents were watching TV, they had their Casper book. And when Harvey went out of the market, it actually created this strange flux, this huge gap for all these other publishers. And in the 80s, as you guys maybe can speak to, comic books really were not a stable market. And when Harvey left, it kind of sent a ripple that eventually, you know, Oley's got the whole backstory with Marvel, but comic books changed, and the industry changed dramatically after that point. When Harvey was rebranded in Los Angeles, my family sold the company. They made the movies, the Richie Rich movie, the big blockbuster with Macaulay Culkin, Casper the Friendly Ghost, which was Steven Spielberg, Christina Ritchie was in it, Bill Clinton. And they had huge splashes, and they were doing all this stuff to Hanna-Barbera. You know, Hanna-Barbera, they were good friends with the Harveys, and, you know, they wanted to put Scooby-Doo and the Jetsons and Popeye, and they wanted to get these characters back in the comic book market. And they may have done a little bit of a resurgence. It didn't really last for that long, but I think that may have had a factor into where Marvel and where DC and Archer are today. Leo, I wanted to bring it to you, because you're running Crescent City.
Yeah.
How many Harvey books do you sell now?
In terms of, like, the current characters and series, you know, like Catherine has a series, DC owns the
rights to like Flintstones and Jetsons and all the Hanna-Barbera stuff that they've done crossovers with in the past couple of years. And that stuff sells in kind of a low to medium range. You know, there's not like a giant fan base that's constantly getting into these characters to kind of replenish the ranks. And part of that is kind of like what Dee was talking about. It's like as the adults grow up, and you know, as like a side note, like the most brilliant thing that Neil Gaiman has ever done is start writing children's books, so all the people who grew up reading Neil Gaiman will buy those books for their children. And that's more or less how a lot of kids get into comics. You know, we see a lot of kids that come to our store now, and they want, you know, DC Superhero Girls, they want, you know, Miles Morales right now. They want kind of their versions of the Marvel characters that their parents are, like, pushing down on them, or DC characters, whatever the publisher might be.
But backing up a little bit, kind of talking about the teaser there, it's like one of the impressive things about Harvey that I think is that, you know, when you look at the list of characters from the beginning in like 1938, and they're doing, it's a mix of genres.
You know, I mean, you're not going to see too often a Babe Ruth comic, you know, next to like the Fighting American or like the Spirit, you know, I mean, so that's a big variety of genre there that, you know, you can go from Will Eisner's Spirit to like the Cats and Jammer Kids, which was like the Simpsons at that time. You know, so it seemed like they were doing something that had an agenda outside of purely like money making. Like, we're going to create this kind of genre for children to be able to always access these comics and kind of do that on indefinite basis until it just didn't work anymore. But that to me was always one of the impressive things that you don't see too much now. You look at Marvel and DC being subsidiaries of Disney and Warner Brothers, and they're just putting out as many comics as they can to meet their quota, make their quarter, make their year, make more money than they did last year. And it's like, okay, I don't have any problem with that, but let's dedicate ourselves to doing something. And so it'd be nice to see a publisher come in and say, like, hey, we're just going to do all ages stuff, but like, we're going to have this kind of sideline and really try to accomplish something, you know. I'm digressing a bit, but
who is your favorite Harvey character?
My favorite Harvey character? Unfortunately for me, like, the 89 kind of stretch is the part that I'm most familiar with. In 89, like, I was already reading, like, Batman Dark Knight Returns, and, I mean, I grew up reading comics, and so my reading level is a little higher than some other kids. But, I mean, I was definitely, you know, familiar with, like, the Scooby-Doo's and the Tom and Jerry's and, like, the things like that.
Derrick, I'd be curious, how many children do you have?
I have five daughters and a granddaughter.
How many Harvey characters do you think that they know?
I think my youngest daughter knows Casper for sure.
She definitely knows Casper. That's probably about it for her. I'm definitely going to, after this, like, get her hooked on some Felix the Cat, though, because I have to.
I wanted to talk about Harvey in the 90s. I mentioned before they did a couple big splashes with the movies. Oley knows firsthand what the industry was like, and he can kind of go into his backstory a bit. And Oley and I have talked about this, but I have a feeling that what Harvey did influenced a lot of these other comic book companies to do the kind of movies that they were doing today.
I don't know if it was, it's always hard to put like a direct line to what was happening in one decade to the next decade. As Leo pointed out, it's, you know, what sells, what's making money. It was difficult in the early 90s because, unfortunately, even my Fantastic Four movie was kind of lumped into the Marvel, the small Marvel debacle films that they had done. And everybody was kind of like, Jesus, those movies are shit. And you know, we did make a good movie, but I can look at it personally and say there are some scenes in the film that are shit. Because, well, you know, we didn't have CGI, we didn't have big special effects. But what we did have for us, and it goes back to the initial question, is what really are the characters all about? What drives these stories? What drives people to go back and read a comic book? A comic book isn't filled with CGI and visual effects. Comic books are based on great characters. And I think that's what, when we were talking earlier about the characters in the Harvey universe, you know, it's the same thing that goes for any comic book character. You have to have a basis of which anybody that's reading the comic can identify with them. Everybody identifies. I get Wonder Woman sitting right here. They identify with her for I know there's probably beauty in there, but there's also power and empowerment and heroism and all the other good things that people can identify with. And going back to what we were trying to do in the early 90s, specifically with the Fantastic Four, was to go back to the original comic. I went to the Golden Apple, which was a big comic book store on Melrose Avenue in Los Angeles when I was living out there at the time, and decided that I was gonna buy every reissue of comic book number one, and there were 12 of them there. I got them all, gave them all to the heads of the departments that we were, you know, the costume designer and the set designer and so on and so forth. And they also had the hardbound copies of every Fantastic Four comic book from its inception. And I bought all those so we could go back, and me particularly as the director of a film, wanted to go back and read everything I could read about the universe, the characters, and understand really what they were all about. And I think that that's coming from what I've been reading now about, and I'd forgotten, frankly, I'll be honest with you, forgotten really what these characters were all about, even in the Harvey world, because when I was reading this, I was a kid. I didn't even know why, but I guess subconsciously, you kind of figure out, gee whiz, Casper, he can materialize, he can walk through a wall. Wendy the Good Witch can fly on a broomstick. I mean, Lotta could lift up, you know, ice cream trucks or whatever. But at the same time, they were all doing this for something good, and you can identify with them as characters in a sense that they, as a kid, I could identify with them because they knew how to get inside the consciousness of the kid. They were writing it for children. I told Jonny when I met with him, I said, they must have had some kind of child psychology or some child psychologist working with them when they were writing these stories, because they really hit a nerve. And the way they portrayed the symbols of authority in there, the parents, the teachers, the aunts, the uncles, all the people that were on the backs of all these young characters to do things that they wanted them to do it their way and not the way they wanted to do it. Casper was with a group of really scary ghosts, and he didn't want to be a scary ghost. You know, that's like the point of all of these characters. They were against type. And anyway, that's, I guess the bottom line is, if you don't have good characters, and we tried our damnedest to make a movie in the Fantastic Four film, that the characters were really good, well-drawn, you knew who they were, and that's it. I mean, that's the bottom line. You just try to go for something that is gonna be satisfying to anybody who watches the film or reads a comic book, that they can identify with those characters. But anyway, you have a question.
Very good at getting to the core of character. Is there a way that Harvey's going to kind of look into the future? I mean, when I was a kid, my parents were the ones that pulled the comic books off the stands, and I was reading comics to the dog on the way to Florida from Pittsburgh for vacation, because there were no iPads and video games and kind of stuff to while away the time. Is Harvey looking towards an iPad or like interactive comics to kind of bring these characters to the newest young generation?
Well, I can kind of speak about what DreamWorks Animation, which owns Classic, which owns the Harvey properties now, is doing. But I can't speak for them on what their plans are from an interactive point of view. But now they have a show on Netflix, which is renewed for season two. It's called The Harvey Street Kids, and it's all about the girl characters. And Tiny's in there, and Melvin, and the whole gang, and it's always Saturday, and they have everyday problems, and they're hanging out, and it's like a mixture between like the Powerpuff Girls and I don't know, like an old Cartoon Network show from back in the day, but it's really geared towards, you know, four-year-old girls. You know, have them check it out. I want to see what they actually think about it.
I'll make sure they watch it. I'll watch it with them and I'll recite it line for line, especially the opening theme, I'm sure.
Thank goodness. But what they've done with those characters is they've kind of reimagined them to a younger audience. Harvey, especially those characters, they had skipped a few generations. And so they attempted to now kind of figure out how do we make these characters resonate with a younger audience. And you know, something we're very curious about is, do they resonate with those characters? In the comic books, they've started a new line of comic books where they've kind of reimagined the characters. They're more emoji head shaped characters than the original Harvey stuff. Do kids relate more with emoji type artwork now? I don't know, I don't have that answer. But I'd be curious to find out. But they are trying to reimagine the characters to actually bring the youngest of kids back in. I'm not sure how well it's working yet, but it's a really good question, and I'd be curious to know, you know, myself. Jack the Jokers, Richie Rich, Jack the Jokers. We were talking about Tiny, and we were talking about little Audrey, and I thought it would be a good opportunity, if you guys wanted to see a little rough cut, a little teaser that's not out to the public.
Yeah.
Yeah? Rob wants it?
The way that Harvey would take something like a little Audrey wants to solve a problem with, you know, I can't fish here. Okay, so I'm not going to break the rules. I'm not going to go into the area and fish there. What I'm going to do is hook my fishing pole to a kite.
Audrey was your neighborhood child that was very smart, very witty. She was ingenious in the way that she would solve her problems.
This is a case for a private eye, Audrey.
The way you had to treat Audrey was to build on the characters with her.
I think Harvey Publications was much more progressive in terms of trying to integrate the background and the characters and the neighborhood where Audrey and even her friends lived.
One of her friends in her little world was a character named Tiny.
When I was a kid, I loved Tiny. Tiny was different because he was a black child in the Harvey world, but there was never any mention of why he was there. He wasn't different than anybody else.
There was not attention drawn to it, but it was important simply because most comics at that time showed a white world. Most children's media at that time showed a white world.
It wasn't a black character. I mean, amongst all these white kids, and then so we built one. And it worked.
It was really important for Harvey to just show this diversity without drawing attention to it.
You'd see him with his family, with his mother and dad, the same way little Audrey would be with his mother and dad, or little Lotto would be with his mother and dad. And then Tiny would go off and have adventures, sometimes by himself, sometimes with kids in his comic strip, sometimes in other people's comic strips, like I think he was in a little dot for a while.
But the key is that no one else was doing this, that for its time, it was very innovative.
So, thank you. So what I talk with these guys about a lot, and I find really fascinating, is that I didn't grow up in the 50s. I'm 24 years old. But I guess segregation was really intense, and the media didn't really portray that. And that woman that you heard is a professor of children's media and pop culture, and she's got PhDs, and she understands the whole history of all that. But I'd be curious to hear your guys' thoughts on comic books and, you know, how... I know Black Panther, I guess, was made in the 60s by Stan Lee, but what was the comic book history of, you know, integrating, you know, different races and different
socioeconomic situations?
I mean, it was certainly tricky, you know, like we were talking about, or mentioned Will Eisner as the spirit earlier, and Will Eisner is pretty much regarded as the father of the graphic novel, and he had stereotypical portrayals of black people in his comics. You know, there was, I forget the character's name, who was that guy? He was in the movie, and they changed him up a little bit, made him not so drastically bad. But in the comics,
he's talking about a
cab driver kid, right?
Yeah,
in
Gorilla.
In wait, what?
In Black Panther.
Yeah, he's talking about the
actor.
Yes.
Oh.
He was, but in the book, he was a gorilla. Yeah. He was a white gorilla in the comic book.
Oh right, yeah. But anyway, in the '50s, yeah, it was still, you know, the trouble there, and you know, you see things like Miles Morales, who I mentioned earlier, you know, and he has only just appeared within the last 8 years. And you can see a bit of a difference in just that, you know, a little less than a decade between the people that when Miles Morales first appeared, you know, would come into the comic shop and tell you to your face, like, why is there a black Spider-Man? Like, this doesn't make any sense. This should be. It's like, well, come on, like, you're willing to buy into the notion that some guy gets bit by a radioactive spider and gets superpowers, but you refuse to think of an idea that maybe one of these people could be black, you know? And, you know, you saw it with other minority characters like Miss Marvel and things like that, but we've come a long way now to where, I mean, a cartoon just premiered with Miles Morales as the main character, and now, like, kids are all, like, looking for it, and it doesn't matter what the other people think. They're gonna latch on to Miles the way that, you know, a kid in the you know, mid-80s, early 90s would have latched on to Richie Rich. It's just a kind of a different vibe now, in a good way.
I agree, and with comics now, there is a lot of empowerment within all of the characters. Everything is deep-rooted. We have LGBTQ, elemental P, ABC. Not to take a stab, but I can never say LGBTQ without stuttering a little bit. It's a lot of letters. But we have characters that represent every type of sickness, mental illness, race, creed, code, and they overcome and become a part of society, and they live with their struggle. And I grew up with Peter Parker, and he was a broke guy that worked at a paper place. And then we got Miles, and I'm like, okay, you know, I'm digging the black Spider-Man. It's pretty cool. I'm still stuck on Peter because he was my Spider-Man, but now that my daughter's watching Spider-Verse and she's loving Miles, and like, I gotta give Miles his props because, you know, it's working. And there was a variant cover for Black Panther that they put out recently, and it was two young black kids looking up at a poster of a Black Panther poster, and the two little black kids resembled the people in the poster, and at the bottom of the book it says, "That's me." And that's a big deal when children relate to something, especially in this world, because there's so many dark things and negative news and negative energy out. When children can latch on to something that gives them a strength to, like, carry on and help others and be brave, I just think it's a big deal.
Very good. Growing up in the South, I'm sure if anybody's done a little of their homework in history, what it was like here back in the 60s. I literally, as a kid, when we would go to the shopping center to go to the TGNY to get comic books, because that's where they were at the time. They weren't at, they were at the drugstore, the TGNY, which is a five and dime store. They were literally, water fountains that were still marked white and colored, and it was just, that's just the way it was. And the one thing that I'm happy to say that I think in reading comic books and literature and other things too, but comic books were easier to digest and did say something about acceptance. And you look at all of the Harvey characters, you know, you don't go on first impressions. Everybody gets a second chance in the comic book world, I think, for the most part. And there's always a moral compass or a moral lesson hidden or written, or some of them not so hidden, pretty obvious, that you have to give everybody a chance. And I think that was one of the things that I found as a kid, I think psychologically, including like when I was reading Spider-Man, I would see spiders in the house and I wouldn't step on them. I started catching spiders and putting them outside.
I have to interrupt because I actually did the same thing until I was about 23 and I got bit by a spider. But I love spiders up until that point. It bit me and my veins started running. Red line going up, my chest started hurting, and I had to go to the hospital, and ever since then I've been a spider killer. And I didn't even get a chance to walk on walls. I was kind of upset.
So, but anyway, that's that, you know, growing up in that world as a kid, I think it was helpful for us to see these characters from other worlds and look different and but had power, and they, I don't know, I think that was an important factor in changing a lot of people's minds as kids, you know, to be, you know, one of the good guys or one of the bad guys, because I'm sure a lot of kids out there, or a few of them, you hope, only a few, identified with the villains, but look, even Darth Vader had a heart, right? Took off his helmet and found out he was a dad, so. Anyway,
wait a minute.
So anyway, weird one, nonetheless. Anyway,
do you guys think that Harvey's characters would resonate with children today?
Hell yeah, they definitely would. If there was a resurgence with good writers and people, and especially with all the situations today, there could definitely be a powerful resurgence of the Harvey characters. Yes. On TV and in comics, I think definitely they were also independent, but they also could coexist with each other and do kind of like a little Rascals thing. Like they overcame problems together. That was what was cool about them. Like they could do their own thing, and then you put them all together, and it was even better. But they always was a fairness, and friendship was also very big. And doing things together, overcoming and learning lessons from each other was, I think, a big part of it. I like that.
All right, cool. Well, I'm going to invite executive producer of Ghost Empire, Declan Ryan, to the stage. He's going to tell you guys what promotional stuff we're doing, and then we'll wrap up because there's something else is happening.
What's up? Thank you all for coming out today. There's a lot more people than I thought, which is awesome. This whole experience is cool so far. We have, on the way out, I know most of you are going to go to the bathroom and forget, but put your name and email address on a piece of paper out on that table out there, and we'll inform you what's going on. We'll let you know when the movie's coming out, if there's discounts and all cool shit, and all the stuff that you guys want to collect, we'll also let you know about it. So if you wouldn't mind giving us your email address, that would be awesome, because you're really our first fans. You guys are the first, so we want to keep you as long as we can. But, thank you very much for coming out.
And once this one succeeds, you will get over to the Hanna-Barbera next. That'll be part two. And then it'll be a trilogy and we'll get into the adults one. It'll be awesome. Then we'll get a deal with Netflix.
All right, guys. Hey, thank you for coming out. We'll be hanging out. We got a table and a booth outside. I'll be hanging out. Come up to all of us. Thanks for coming.
You're welcome.